Professor Scarshell, can you hear my voice clearly?
Always, Jim.
Okay.
he's our associate then.
Do we have any special announcement today? Other than this lecture? No? Okay, I'm just make sure everything's covered, so.
Is this working, or?
It's only for the people online.
Oh, okay, that's why I didn't hear my voice.
All right.
Okay, I'm just gonna read a little bio to introduce tonight's speaker. So Eric Osth is managing a principal with Urban Design Associate in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Eric serves as a principal in charge on urban design and architecture projects across the US and abroad. He previously served as the 2011 president of the board of directors for the AI Pittsburgh chapter. Prior to joining UDA, Eric served as a senior designer at Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, directing an urban design team on projects in California and Shanghai, China. Eric is a cum laude graduate of the University of Miami, holding a Bachelor of Architecture degree. He also received a Master of Urban Design degree from the UC Berkeley on a university fellowship. Please join me welcoming Eric Osth.
Before I start my lecture, I have to mention that for those who are architects, your hour will not be completely wasted today. The LTU lecture series is a continuing education opportunity for you, and per the AI requirements, we have to share the learning objectives. I'd like to start my lecture today with this quote. I had the good fortune to have Charles Correa as a faculty member when I was in graduate school, and he talked about this quite a bit, and this particular quote meant something to me while I was a student, but as I practice more and more, it seems like it means so much, and it really does, I think, capture a lot of the essence of what we do. So he was paraphrasing Jack Robertson, and so this is somewhat paraphrased, but designing a building on Bedford Square is easy. Bedford Square is the machine, and I'm designing the spare part. However, working in America is harder, where I feel like I'm designing amongst a bunch of spare parts with no one specifically in charge of the machine. To kind of put that into kind of a graphic diagram in this sketch, you see, I mean, on the left is kind of the Bedford Square example. It's kind of a pre-auto era type of space. And when you're doing practice there, you're usually designing something that's very architectural. You know, there are urban design issues. How is that programmed? How are you reacting or reflecting the context around you? But really today, you know, in working in America, there's a lot more post-auto era type of spaces. There's not as many Bedford Squares to practice within. So oftentimes you are trying to figure out how to pull together these spare parts and think about what you're going to do and where you want to be, whether or not it's an architectural problem or an urban design one. And those spare parts may not be just buildings. They may be open spaces. They may be issues related to economy, social issues and things like that you're trying to pull together to make something and make a place. So building off urban neighborhoods is tricky, and there's a lot more to talk about than what we can just talk about in this hour today. So I've only picked a few aspects of that. But like I mentioned, you're oftentimes doing kind of, pedestrian-oriented retrofitting to automobile era relics, things that are left over from the automobile era. And because as we're adding density, that's in effect what you're doing. But the problem is what we're fearing today is that, as the suburbs were built and so many people criticize the suburbs, they oftentimes are criticizing the monotony and the sameness. You can get a lot of excitement in that kind of density, but it's the monotony of it that people are sometimes reacting to. And what we're fearful of is that as people build neighborhoods and build cities, they're just building density, but they're not building the essential qualities of real urban life and qualities of neighborhoods. So there are some key ingredients here that we're going to talk about. I'm going to show you four examples of work that reflect these kinds of things. Design, location, density, and programming are really essential characteristics that go into that. But we understand that this is more than spare parts, and spare parts is kind of like a machine-oriented analogy. I understand that, and I'm sure Jack Robertson did too. It's important to think about the fact as you're practicing that you're not just doing just a project, you're not just doing kind of figural urbanism and shapes, spaces, but you really are providing kind of frameworks for growth and for things to happen and places to evolve, both in, you know, urban design, but also as architecture can change and grow and evolve with the place. So when you're rebuilding, you want to rebuild or build, you know, in the kind of spirit of a place, and the key to that is really listening to people, listening to your clients, and going forward with a kind of open ear and kind of listening to place as you design your process. That listening was really part of the launch of the idea of UDA. Urban Design Associates, the name was the first kind of name without a kind of series of last names, which is the kind of the style at the time. We were formed in 1964. Urban Design Associates means that we, with our clients, constituents, everybody together, we're designing cities. And at the same time, in 1964, I mean, everybody was leaving cities at that time. It was, they were leaving them for dead. And at the time, this was kind of a crazy idea, the fact that maybe cities have value, and that we could solve issues like kind of issues in the civil rights movement, is that maybe if we put people together in streets and places, maybe we can learn from each other and there's maybe more in common than we think. So that came really through, and that's important. That was important to yesterday, it's important today, and it's important to tomorrow. So we've found that really listening can provide better outcomes to design. And so I'm gonna show you some of the examples of some work that reflect part of that listening. So, the first example project I'm going to go through is a work with a townhome builder that we're working with in Salt Lake City in Daybreak, Utah. And this the theme that I want to share with you here is about connecting kind of affordability and design. That is one of the critical issues that we have to look to in the future, is making sure that design is accessible to everyone. So, you know, and I think that one thing, and I was in architecture school too, and I don't know where LTU is specifically, but generally across the country, people disregard production builders. They don't realize that production builders really are the kind of forgotten contributors to the American landscape. They actually always have. As architects, we like to think, oh, we really designed, we really set things up, and we certainly have designed the wonderful buildings, the moments of delight that have shocked you and taken your breath away. But oftentimes, when you look at the large percentage of the landscape, the large percentage of neighborhoods, and I'm talking centuries back, most of them were by builders. And one thing that's important about builders is that they really do think at the human scale. They understand what their buyer wants from within, what they want to, you know, how people want to live. And that's important. As an architect, we sometimes feel like we think it would be cool for, that's going to be really cool. We want people to have what we like. And that's a mistake in marketing across every stretch of the imagination. But certainly in architecture, it's important to bring your design to bear on things, but to understand what people are looking for at different parts of their lives. Builders understand that. But what they've been missing over time is that they have not necessarily been building neighborhoods. They've forgotten that part. So, you know, when I started looking into some of the numbers as I was preparing this talk, and I knew it was a lot, but I just found out that over 1.2 million housing starts in the month of December were by home builders. Or just housing starts. Housing by the NAHB, that's National Association of Home Builders, is described as single family houses, townhouses, apartments, and condominiums. So when you think about that, 1.2 million, that's an extraordinary number. And according to NAHB, 80% of those are by companies that consider themselves home builders. So, you know, I worked in single family residential for 3 years, and it was a wonderful experience. I thought it was extraordinary. But I realized that I was really living to and working to make sure that two families had just like an incredibly perfect morning every time they woke up, and that, you know, their experience in the kitchen was just top notch. And that was great, but When I realized that as I looked forward to my career, I wanted to make sure that I was influencing a greater number of people than just those two families. So what I wanted to talk about is that if you want to be part of the conversation and want to really make an influence on landscape, work with production builders and bring design there. So historically, as I mentioned, when you look back on the great American neighborhoods, they were built by builders. You know, like the house on the left, those are all the same house with just subtle differences. And those were built usually from pattern books. You can see the one on the right, you know, and they were developed by architects. And So, you know, oftentimes, I mean, those neighborhoods always had their issues together, you know, in some cases. But when you think back, oftentimes they were by builders. So what's happening today in a lot of places when they're starting to match design and builders, they're really going back to the tradition of building great neighborhoods. So I'm going to start with Daybreak, which is the a town. We got involved with Daybreak after the first year. It started in 2004. We got involved in 2005. It really is a city of itself. And they've decided that to build it by using production home builders to do it. It's the master developer decided from the get-go that they were going to make design as part of the brand of the community and insist on it. And they matched up designers with production builders to make design happen, to make changes in neighborhoods. I don't think when you look at Daybreak today, I mean, there's some wonderful moments about it. It probably can't be held to the same standard that you can by some of the East Coast communities, perhaps. But the length that they the dimension what they've come how far they've come in just 10 years has been extraordinary compared to where they were. Really, in terms of a production builder landscape, it was probably the worst in the United States in 2004, and now it's amazing to see the transformations. Daybreak is a place with 13,000 if you have 13,500 homes with broad segmentations from affordable houses all the way to high income. It has a fully functioning downtown that's on the way. You can see the image on the right by UDA. We've done neighborhood planning within, and the downtown will have it has two current light rail stops. It's going to have a third. The size of the downtown is actually comparable in scale to downtown Salt Lake City. And this is just outside of Salt Lake. It's very much based on walking as well. So you can see this is the kind of aerial looking across. The view to the mountains is actually pretty extraordinary, the downtown in the middle. This is it at kind of full build out. And today, you can see the lake there and some of the residential houses around the edges. The lake actually serves a stormwater management system. It's part of a stormwater management system. The parks and amenities are all walkable and kind of channel you towards schools and the downtown area and walking trails. On the left, you see a Class A office building that's nested right in one of the residential neighborhoods and adjacent to the downtown, one of the small kind of village centers, and so it has a broad kind of all different types of architecture, everything you kind of would like to see, and it has that kind of tension that cities have in terms of things that don't necessarily, it doesn't actually have kind of one design or one sense of one kind of move. It's very much a lot of different people contributing together. This is kind of an overall framework plan. The master plan was by Calthorpe, and then we've been able to work with Daybreak Communities and Stephen James, the developer, over time to work on some specific neighborhood planning. The neighborhood that I'm going to show you is the kind of salmon-colored site in there, which is located in this map. This is kind of a backing up a little bit. I'll kind of start to zoom in on the site. You can see the lake to the north and some of the walking trails and greenway connections to the south. The village center, which I just showed you the photograph, is the red buildings there in the center. Kind of zooming in, we have residential neighborhoods to the south. What happened was the salmon-colored buildings right here were part of the idea of, again, a little bit of that kind of automobile-oriented retail that was never coming off the ground. They built the other red buildings, but they realized that they did not have the demand for the retail quite like they thought they did. That's something that I'm going to talk about later is kind of the future of retail. But again, we were kind of working with some spare parts. There's kind of two one-way couplets around the site that made it very difficult to get across. So our site was this red boundary here. I wish I had a laser pointer, but so we were really lining the residential neighborhoods and trying to have an opportunity to actually drive through a neighborhood. So the first thing we did was look at connections. That's one of the critical things we've noticed, that if you're building new or building working on existing cities, if you can connect things that are working with things that are not working, generally you'll find success right behind it. So that's everybody oftentimes asks, what's the silver bullet? And there's not really necessarily one particular silver bullet, but if you make connections for people, cognitive connections, physical connections, people will generally make things work. So the idea was to break down the scale of that block along these green corridors here and to create different urban blocks for growth, which you can start to see the townhouses that start to come into place. And finally, our master plan. So we had three different small parks within the block. So all of these townhouses either had a street address or they were on a green space in and of themselves. And then we consolidated the parking into a block to the north, which is kind of maybe a future block for growth as well. So this became the three different addresses within the open space perpendicular to the kind of public space, which we'll talk about in a minute. We also, when you're working with a production home builder, you have a kind of kit of parts. They have three plans that they wanted to take to the market. So we worked with them on taking those three plans and actually creating different kind of like what we call suits of clothes or whatever you'd want to say, but something kind of different looks to that. And then we were able to assemble them into different buildings. You can see the building below here that sits on one of the major roads there through it, and then another one of them that sits on the green. They are actually, some of them actually are four stories tall. They are, buildings are sprinkled. But again, we were able to kind of create a good variety between textures and materials and color. But the goal here was actually to provide products that were affordable. Cost terms, these were what we call vertical construction, exclusive of land. This was about $75 a square foot, which is extremely affordable in today's building costs. So we had to be very, when you're working at that cost, you have to be very clear that you want to pick your moments. So you have the relatively few windows to choose from. You don't always have all the colors you want. But we were really trying to provide livability for everyone. So a lot of these have roof terraces above, you can see. And we're really trying to put the living space focused on the open spaces. In Salt Lake, generally, the initially, we always see that the houses usually have a kind of, they usually put the garage to the front, and then they put the living space out the back. Here we were trying to reverse that, and we understand this isn't for everyone, but really to try to create neighborhoods where people connect. So and all of these have terraces and some sort of public space on the balconies on the front that front the public space as well. So here you can see some of the details as well. Again, off the rack windows, off the rack materials, and all of the wood you can see was actually meant to be field cut, so that it was very done very simply, so that it could be done by contractors. And things like these separation walls, which had kind of texture, the kind of horizontality to kind of contrast with the verticality of the units and provide different shadow patterns was also another device. We also have rolling shutters you may have seen on the other ones, the other units as well, so that you can modulate the light within and change it. But again, these were kind of, could be quickly manufactured by the builder. But the site plan offered us the opportunity to also create some of these kind of almost medieval street moments, which in the process of developing, as I mentioned about developing new spaces and kind of at urban densities, is we want to make sure you have the kind of moments of surprise and interest that you don't get of just kind of repetitive streets or the same sections, which is what people oftentimes create concern about the suburbs. So one of the things about Daybreak was they're very interested in creating these kind of surprise moments, which is kind of makes things unique, and it does provide design at, again, affordable level. The second example to share with you is here in Detroit. I understand from Dr. Kim you were talking about, you guys have been discussing affordable housing and mixed income housing over time. But the issue that, and the issues of gentrification a lot of people talk about, but it seems like it's a better discussion, and one of the, we think one of the most critical issues facing our cities today is connecting jobs and housing. That's the real problem. When I lived in the Bay Area, around the I think we moved out about 2003, excuse me. One of the issues of the Bay Area was they were definitely facing this problem where people were living, 2 hours from downtown, minimum wage earners, and they were the ones that were punished the most. They had the highest cost in their BART ticket in downtown. So in terms of when you think about social mobility, it was a real challenge for people to get to their jobs. Whereas the people that had money could buy units right in San Francisco and have a wonderful experience going back and forth to work, and it was and have a lot more time on their hands. So that issue of jobs and housing is something that a lot of cities felt like, oh, we don't have that problem. But today, fast forward 20 years, 15 years, and now many more cities are having this problem today. So proximity is driving value, and it's really pushing affordable housing away from the jobs. That's a serious problem. So I want to back up for a minute, and I want to just talk about a project that definitely shaped housing policy, and because I want to share this with you as the students. And if you haven't, if you don't know this project, you should look it up because it's an important story and really shaped housing policy for a long time. It's Pruitt-Igoe. Pruitt-Igoe was developed as a response to a kind of political mandate to address blighted neighborhoods in St. Louis. And this was one of many projects across the country. Robert Trailer Homes in Chicago is another example of the idea of the Corbusian dream of green spaces in between towers that could provide light and air and all this thing. Now, they were coming from a context of dilapidated townhomes where things were very dark. What they had forgotten is there was definitely a social structure for that. So the social structure was broken when it was moved in the towers, but also there became a considerable amount of anonymity and the idea that all of a sudden you lived in a project. You lived in a place that had a kind of social stigma of that kind of issue. But there was also another kind of fundamental problem about Pruitt-Igoe was that it was designed to get people on their feet, to get people back out into the world. And the problem was when they tied the maintenance of the buildings to the rent structure. So this is a little bit of a tangent, but it's an important one, is that as they got people out of Pruitt-Igoe, the quality of the maintenance of all the buildings, they couldn't all of a sudden maintain the elevators. Then all of a sudden, people can't get up to their, you know, elderly can't get to their units, and then it becomes, and then the staircases become an issue. So it was a disastrous experiment from a number of reasons, from both a social one and both an economic one. So this definitely shaped policy away from warehousing people and bringing people into much more dignified housing that allowed for their kind of for more social equity and kind of sense of social mobility in the design. And the one on the right, by the way, is Crawford Square. This was a project by Urban Design Associates in the early 80s with McCormick Barron, where the kind of concept of it was, it was actually the first one, but that no building was the same. So it almost bankrupted us, but you know, so we didn't have a kind of, but nevertheless, that was one of the ones that, that was with McCormick Barron, the same developer I'm going to share with you, Orleans Landing. So mixed income was really promoted for promoted for neighborhood economic and social stability today because it's an excellent tool for revitalization. And what happens is you maintain the presence of affordable housing in urban neighborhoods. So when you talk about gentrification, if you can have affordable housing as a component, you're definitely putting people where jobs are. In that case, because generally that's where people are building these days. So, and one thing that's an important quote I want to add, we had the opportunity to work with the National Endowment for the Arts and Habitat for Humanity in 2007. And at that time, there was many national research studies that actually found that a large percentage of Americans would accept affordable housing in their neighborhood if it fit in. That's the caveat, that's important, if it fit in. That tells you that it's not a social issue, it's an architectural one. So that's the challenge to you as architects. So when you think about that, that people understood that the people that were living there were not necessarily people they don't want to be around, but they didn't want things that distracted from their architectural, their beauty, or their sense of place of their neighborhood. So that's an important thing, and it goes back to that providing design for everyone. So this project, some of you may be aware of it, but it's in Rivertown. It's on north of it is East Jefferson Avenue. To the west is downtown. And there's a whole series of neighborhoods, and we actually provided an early master plan for this along the Detroit River that you can see the study area there in orange, Lafayette Park to the north. So it's a very stable neighborhood, it's a great opportunity to put housing for when you look forward for Detroit. I mean, where would you start? This was one of the places that was designated as an opportunity. There's the site, you probably may be more familiar with it than I am. But one of the important components of it was that there's an existing riverfront trail, which is great, but it's also, there are these green fingers of the Tukunder Cut and open space and trails that connect into the neighborhood. So there's an opportunity to both connect the river to the neighborhoods and the neighborhoods to the river that way. But then creating development blocks are these yellow areas. So there's all the recipes to make this work and to help make those connections better ones into the neighborhoods around. So the context has, as I mentioned, the DeKinder Greenway. There's a kind of rich tradition of some, there's some mixed-use buildings that are in the neighborhood in and of themselves. The Soapstone building, as you see there, some industrial buildings, and the Globe building, which is an old Henry Ford manufacturing building, which has been recently restored by others. So when we were designing, we really established that, again, going back to the fact that this has an affordable component and the cost was an issue, is there's a kit of parts of both bay windows. We had to kind of use off-the-rack windows and configurations of modifying either bay windows, picture windows, and next to double hungs, balconies, string courses at various levels, brick. So we didn't have a lot to work with. We had to modulate color and roof lines and so forth. So together we put them on these kind of those kind of facade compositions on buildings that made blocks and made spaces. So the streets really became the public spaces here. And the kind of key intersection here was one where we actually designated where's a place where you could have a kind of mixed use environment. And we'll talk about retail in a moment, as I mentioned. The buildings had this kind of same pattern, as I mentioned, of kind of string courses. But again, one of the important points about the building was instead of trying to create buildings that are tendency when you design big buildings in these kinds of things to start to try to think of the architecture as one move all the way across. So and we realize that can be very pastiche. It's very, you have to be very cognizant of it. But since we were nesting it into the neighborhood, we were very cognizant of the scale of the buildings of the current neighborhood to try to create a kind of much more walkable scale and one that kind of feels like it fits in. But again, it's very difficult when you're working with very limited parts and pieces in that regard. So this was along, this is the DeKinder Greenway. That's the Galone building in the distance, and then a series of kind of townhomes that fronted in this location also. So, and then this is kind of the main square. In the distance, you can see a Renaissance Center. But again, this is about 280 units. And 20% of those are affordable units. And it is under construction. Here's some of the construction photos there. Chevrolet is very prominently positioned in the shot. And in the distance, you can see it again without the Chevrolet. But nevertheless, you can start to see that we're getting there closer and closer. Now, one of the things that I wanted to mention about this project was that when you're, I was talking about Daybreak, which is a brownfield development. This is a urban revitalization project. When you're doing projects like this, it's one of the challenges is not always what you see; it's what you don't see. One of the issues is as they started working on this project, they ran into an enormous amount of infrastructure issues under the ground. So when you are going back into cities, and I know that's an issue here in Detroit, is that there are unforeseen infrastructure issues that you have to deal with. So sometimes the challenges are not necessarily what you see; it's what you don't see. The third example I'm going to share with you is I'm kind of working up in density here is a city center in Huntsville, Alabama. And this is a really another thing that we're seeing more and more as an issue is how to create public space today. Cities are relatively burdened with all kinds of challenges, and it's so new public spaces really have to be provided for by private development as you move forward, and then they have to plug into the existing ones to try to create a network. So one of the issues here was we had the site that was kind of a former hotel site. You can see it in the foreground here. You can see the kind of red clay color there. To the left is the Von Braun Center, which has kind of nationally important venue for arts. The museum is there in the middle of the park. This park, I was just having a discussion with some of you today right before the lecture about green spaces within cities, and this is really one of when you kind of get in there and you see the museum activated on weeknights with music kind of concerts going on, it's actually one of the great spaces in the South in a downtown. Huntsville's got is a very proud group, but this particular site was one that was, it was not enhancing the park in any way, and it was not providing kind of a framework. And they had these they have these roads that wrap around the park. This is a four-lane road. This is taken at, I took this shot at 8:45 in the morning. So this is rush hour in Huntsville. There are two cars in the road. It's a four-lane road. We actually had to be a little bit hard on Huntsville while we were there. We had to say you are getting a failing grade on bike infrastructure. They actually, I didn't include the photograph, but they actually had a bike rack that was the shape of a bicycle. It was kind of, and I think nobody locked up to it because I think they thought it was art. You know, so I think we were trying to help them get that way. And luckily the city is moving forward with a bike share program, and they've taken on cycling and moving around as part of their city. But they actually have a small, very quaint, historic part of their downtown with a very fine-grained scale. This is a few blocks away. And so the shot that I just showed you is the red at the top. So one of the things that we do is, although we're designing one little site, and this goes back to that image of the Bedford Square and the overall, is that we backed up and we said, okay, although we're kind of only designing this piece, maybe there's a way we can make this read as one space. So we worked with the city on these kind of green pieces here to improve the connections across these roads to help make this one place. And now we're continuing our work with a master plan. My partner's working on a master plan with the city right now for their downtown, which will hopefully do just this. Now, our client in this case was a private developer, but we were working in tandem with the city about shaping the future of the city, which is great. So, but this is, again, trying to figure out what the machine is. So here's some quick sketch diagrams. You can see there's the downtown in green. And the green arrow at the base is kind of a future greenway that's going to connect in all the suburbs. So we said, well, maybe we could find a way to connect into that to help make this one place, this red arrows, and actually front that and actually create a face-to-face retail experience, which is something they do not have in Huntsville right now. So surprisingly enough, even though I showed you that moment in the city, they don't have the kind of true downtown experience. So if you take those, that was our diagram right there in sketch form. So when we got involved in the project, these were the buildings we were given. The developer had actually already moved forward, and they realized they actually brought us in to help kind of save it. So you can see the forms here. You can see where the parking garages are not doing what that needs to do. So these were the buildings that were given. So we said, well, why don't we just turn these around and actually start to think about architecturally treating the garages, fronting roads that were never going to be a place anyway, and then creating a space in between, a new public space that then plugs directly to the park and to the whole sequence through it. And in that case, that green box you see there is now a new public place in Huntsville that would be wired into it. And then as you come into the trail, you know, it actually becomes almost a gateway to the city and a gateway to that urban experience. So this was our new master plan and our framework. So in the public spaces, we actually had retail that wraps all around the spaces, green and hardscape, shared surfaces with bollards and things like that to create a kind of space that works for bikes, cars, and pedestrians together as a kind of full open space framework. So your view towards the park here is, again, where we were kind of taking these very large buildings and kind of breaking them down in scale and color, but also kind of creating a new space that you can move towards the park there and reprogram it and create something that is connected into Huntsville. And from the park side, it now creates a new edge to the park there. As I mentioned, the city was working with us on creating direct connections to the park to flow right in. So this retail will now create a kind of bookend environment from the downtown, as I mentioned, and create a kind of whole loop, but also a kind of complementary kind of retail or food and beverage experience that also helps support the Von Braun Center, which has a kind of problem because people kind of come in, they see a show and they leave and they never stay. So that was the general idea, and that's moving forward today. So again, building up in scale, my fourth example I'll share with you is from where our office is, our hometown of Pittsburgh, which we absolutely adore. And this is another issue that we're seeing in cities more and more. And as I mentioned about, sometimes cities are just building density for the sake of density. But right now, one of the critical issues is how do you ground level program cities? So oftentimes the de facto is, oh, we're just going to put retail there. But when you look at where retail is today, we're kind of a little bit in trouble when you think about that in terms of just as a solution. So as I mentioned, and when I say online retailing is taking hold, you're going to say, oh yeah, no kidding, Eric, we totally know that. And I completely understand that. But it's interesting because we're seeing a lot of bricks and mortar changes just this year. So I was talking to a developer in 2007, and he said, Eric, mark my words, watch 2017. That's when all the changes are going to happen, because they all signed 10-year leases. They all renegotiated, a lot of retailers renegotiated their leases for 10-year leases at rock bottom prices. So you weren't seeing what was kind of a gradual change until today, and now they're all either downsizing. So a lot of like what they call big box stores, you know, kind of are starting to become smaller ones, and then smaller ones are starting to be inline retail, and inline retail is kind of moving to something smaller. And there's a whole future there, and if any one of us knew what the future was going to be, we wouldn't be sitting here. We'd be out doing something else, or and moving forward with that. But when we do get there, we're all going to say, oh, of course, that's exactly what was going to happen. But for sure, it's definitely changing, and it's changing to a much different type of environment. So the question is, what are we going to do? So when you look at it, most cities are based on a municipal sales tax revenue. So we're really looking, we're kind of on the edge of a cliff here on what that's going to mean for cities in general. Are they going to be able to continue to provide the services they provide? We really need it, but as urban designers, we can't control all of that, but how are you going to create a downtown and exciting experience in a downtown? And how are you going to have a ground level programming that means something? The silver lining is, as you get into density, when you developer performas, when they set it up, usually they make all their money off the residential on the above. That's where the lion's share of the money is. The ground level is almost a giveaway. So when you think about it, you actually, in the suburbs, it's very difficult to build a building and have kind of a yoga studio or an art gallery or whatever, just because of the cost of construction. So when you have the ground level is actually subsidized by housing above, you actually have a much richer and a much more exciting experience in downtowns. You can have art galleries, you can have yoga studios, you can have all kinds of things. You can have local retail that may not be able to pay the rents that a Starbucks or some major retailers could pay. So you can actually maybe even have, that's the opportunity there. But what we have noticed is that, and oftentimes people are asking about revitalization, as I mentioned, it's important to connect things together, and we'll talk about that in a second. But it's also, what we have seen is that the arts have a proven track record for revitalization of cities, period. So this is downtown Pittsburgh. This is one of our renderings of kind of an aerial view of our site. Any of those parking lots, that basically this entire two-block area right here with 8th Street down the middle is our site. It's owned by the Cultural Trust, which is an arts group that controls a lot of the ground levels. This whole area of downtown, which is called the are oriented to the Allegheny, which are between Penn Avenue and Fort Duquesne Boulevard. It was actually one of the toughest neighbor parts of downtown, and it was kind of almost like a red light district. But the Cultural Trust went around and started buying up buildings, and then they actually started creating. They programmed all the ground levels with either restaurants or art galleries, and it's a really wonderful experience. They have gallery crawls and all kinds of things that are going on in that location. Our site is right in the heart of it, and the Cultural Trust has held this land for a long time, and now we're looking for a master plan for development. You can see one of our analysis drawings here, where it shows all of the red is our either art galleries or restaurants and all the kind of ground level experience. But you can see in the kind of purple blocks there is kind of the spark gap, literally and metaphorically. So it's somewhat the heart of the cultural district. And you can see there's very good connections to the river right here. There's one right there. You can see, I don't know if, PNC Park, which is the Pirates baseball, is right there. So there's a lot of things that are going on in that direction. The entertainment and the excitement of the downtown is actually jumping the river even today. So this was our master plan. I'm kind of jumping ahead, but you can see that we're trying to create a kind of fine grain of blocks that actually create a kind of walkable scale, but also connect people to the river. This is the site here, from the ground level perspective. This is looking down Penn Avenue. That garage on the left is actually coming down as part of this development, and a new garage, which would be reconfigured and subsidized new development, is actually going into its place in a different configuration. This is looking towards the river, look, and you actually can't see the river, which we're going to talk about in a moment. But again, it's kind of post-automobile area. The buildings have been torn down. It was parking is kind of highest and best use for, was for many years, and but not today. As you saw, these are the last few blocks in downtown Pittsburgh that are empty. Fort Duquesne Boulevard is actually, it's not, when you look at that photograph, you can see it looks like it's leaning to the right. It looks like it because it is. The site is actually lower than the left side, which is the river edge. And then the site actually, the road actually drops down, and there's actually a four-lane road below. When you see that there's not that many cars on it, it's because there really isn't that many cars on it. It is kind of an essential part of downtown, but it's actually been, you can see that the river has actually been blocked by a lot of these ramps and so forth. So the idea of connecting to the river is important. This is the living room for the city of Pittsburgh. This is Market Square. Our office is off to the right. And just on top of it, we help participate in the master plan for this part of the city, and it's been wildly successful. The problem is it's really hard to connect to the cultural district. So one of our efforts was how do we connect this part of downtown to the other one. So we looked at kind of the signage and the directional system to try to make sure that this is part of the system and part of the framework for downtown of connecting Market Square to the river. The master plan was really about was indeed a framework for development, as I mentioned. So although we're going to develop, we're locating the sites for all these buildings, we're actually, in some cases, as I mentioned earlier, we're designing the buildings. In this case, we're not. But we're actually providing kind of the ground level space. We're working with a great great landscape architect, La Quattro Bouncy out of Pittsburgh, who's doing the design for these, for the ground level, which again is like a shared space between the buildings. And then the you can see right here the kind of one of the ideas was to actually have a kind of central space for the cultural district. This is one of the LBA's drawings for the kind of pedestrian idea, this kind of strand, which has a lot of arts and arts uses along it, black box theaters and ground level galleries that help get you across, up the staircase, across and down to the river. Penn Avenue Square, the idea of kind of a covered space that you can have arts venues outside and still be out of the river, out of the rain. I saw the rain on the way here. Pittsburgh weather is just about identical to what you guys have. Actually, your weather is probably better, but nevertheless, Pittsburgh has, there's a lot of wonderful things about Pittsburgh. Weather's not one of them, but when you look down at the distance, you can see there's a pavilion there. Part of that was to actually tell you that the river's there. One of the things that, as I mentioned about connecting things that work with things that don't work, a lot of people sometimes rail against, seaside. They say seaside is, they kind of know it's kind of quirky and new urbanist. But there's some devices in there that are important to know, and it is actually, if you ever get a chance to go, it's an enchanting place. But down at the end of the streets, they have these little pavilions before you get to the water, and they're all designed by many, many well-known architects. But they've been kind of dismissed as kind of cute. But the reason they're there was actually economic development. It was so that you, when you bought a house down the street from the river, from the Gulf, you knew the Gulf was there. It was if they were just looking at trees, you wouldn't connect the two, or you wouldn't feel like you're buying a waterfront lot. So one of the things that we were very eager to do with this one is we didn't have a bridge down the street to tell us that the river's there. So part of that pavilion was to help you see and understand that river as part of the development. And when you got down there, there's actually steps to get you up to second floor terraces with restaurants and hopefully what will eventually be an elevated bridge to get you across to the pavilion over the bypass, as I showed, and back down to the river again with riverfront programming. So this was a very bold and very ambitious plan by the cultural district, but what we're trying to do is trying to put the kind of missing piece in the heart of the cultural district that then makes it all the boats rise with the same tide. And this is a view kind of looking towards the river from the upper terrace there. So again, where arts has kind of helped drive the revitalization of Pittsburgh, it's created a brand that is very much associated with this new development and critical to it. So if we were to kind of dismiss arts and just do it as a residential development, people would actually wonder what happened, why is that missing? So the Cultural Trust is doing a great job of promoting arts in Pittsburgh. it's been one of the key elements to the success of downtown, and we're very proud of to work with them here on this particular project. So again, here's the aerial photograph or the aerial drawing, and then this is kind of the new element, which is a series of kind of residential towers and ground level and low rise residential to again promote views across the city and so forth. So just to kind of wrap things up, I know that we've covered a lot, and there's a lot more to talk about in the revitalization of cities. But we're always going to be working with spare parts, and I guarantee you, in your future, you will too. It's something you're always having a challenge, and how the design challenge is always how do you pull these together and make them make sense for something. We must kind of break down the barriers within cities. One of the things about the automobile area is that there were huge freeways, and there's always rail lines. There's always some sort of barrier. If you can connect one neighborhood to another, you will have success, and you will have kind of cognitive connections that help stimulate revitalization. One of the other ones that I want to mention, too, is that we will always have, in the future, you always have to think creatively about unconventional ways to provide design. It's interesting, when I was president of AIE Pittsburgh, we would go to Harrisburg and we would lobby for the architect's law, which is the law that you it helps protect our turf or our services. We were always on, and it's a little bit like if you're not there participating, you're on the menu. Builders and engineers and everybody's trying to compete for what architects provide. So you're always going to have to compete for that, but you also need to find new ways to provide design to people and help inspire people with design in the future. And last, and most importantly about, like as I mentioned about getting to Harrisburg, is getting, just involve yourself in influencing policy. That is what really shapes design in the end. Without that, you really, it's all for naught. So we can make a difference. You can change cities, and you can do it with what you're learning today at LTU. So thank you very much. Any questions? Questions? Oh, come on. Hi, yeah.
When I was a student years ago back in the 80s, I did a lot of projects that were generated were based on a couple of models, urban redevelopment and city centers, and everyone was going to be employed in the fire sector, finance, insurance, real estate. Mm-hmm. The other model was sort of like the Ben Thompson retail, retail environments where you bought $2 cookies, right?
Yeah.
So what my question is today, where do you see the direction, so to speak, in terms of development? What are the catalysts, what are the types of uses, so to speak, that you might see in the future?
The question is, what are the catalysts and what are the types of development we're starting to see in the future? It's interesting because that question is an interesting one, particularly post recession. That was where there was a huge shift between the kind of development market in the development area, and it was very much qualitative. People went on a hunch and they went on kind of what they believed. And there's been a lot more kind of spreadsheet development going on today. A lot of the developers are now, a lot of those development groups were bought by REITs, real estate investment trusts, and so they're very much driven by a percentage of short-term gain, rather than looking at the long view. So more and more, it's actually one of the tough things about our cities right now is people are really looking at for financial gain, wherever it may be. So what you're finding is a lot of times people are kind of going to the next thing. So we're seeing a huge amount of kind of large-scale residential blocks right now. It's almost an overheated market in that. And it's surprising, some of the kind of economic indicators that we've seen from some economic groups have showed that they think that that right now almost all the sectors have actually shown significant growth, which is not always a good thing. Sometimes it's kind of a bellwether that there's a recession coming. But in terms of, if I got your question right, it's in terms of what's the kind of next thing. It's interesting. generally what I think the market is demanding is more authentic places and more ones that are kind of have a rich mix of uses. I don't know if I can. It's not quite as clear as it used to be. You mentioned a lot of times, there was a period of time where it was like lifestyle centers and things like that. But it certainly is. I don't think there's anything really clear out there today that I feel like, gosh, that's the one. But in general, I think all of the, because of the kind of issues of kind of financial modeling, there's a kind of very conservative investor group out there that are looking to what to do out there, is if that answers your question. So it's not quite as much fun as it used to be. So. And there we go. Yes.
Had in your tenets this idea of spirit of
the
place.
Yep.
I'd like to hear you talk more specifically about that a little bit more rigorously.
Sure.
It's a good thing to say.
Mm-hmm.
No disrespect, but the drawings of these places that you're designing, so many of them. You could have lined those all up, and I would have said they were all the same project. So it seems to me that maybe it's because they're all drawn in the same style or something, it seems to me that one of the issues has to do with time and thinking about time and how projects age. And so maybe part of the answer could address this issue of decay or weathering or things that grow beyond their boundaries, things like that that make places that do make places have a spirit of place.
So the question is, for the benefit of the audience, is that what about the tenet of spirit of place? And your question was spot on, is kind of why is that, where is that in some of our projects, and how does that, what about age and what about decay and about cities, and how does the spirit of place come alive in our project? Just to point out, one of the questions you asked specifically is, you said, well, some of the renderings look very similar, they could almost be the same place. One of the ways that we address place, and I didn't talk about it, and one of the ways that we, and I mentioned early on about listening, is that, and that's one of the most important parts of what we do, is we oftentimes do, we are listening, and we are doing outreach groups, and we usually work with people early on about, what's working about your community, what's not working, and where are the opportunities. So you're actually trying to slice it and trying to get people to really give you feedback. So those kinds of things go directly into our projects, and oftentimes when we start a project, we'll actually do kind of written design principles, and we'll show that as a thread of starting to develop alternatives and how those alternatives then work, and we'll get feedback from economic, feedback, social feedback, from political feedback and things like that, and then they eventually move forward. And what you see in our renderings when we are finished are actually represent a process to getting there that is part of something that is connected to actual residents and people that live there. And so people are participating in the design of our process. We are the pen. We are doing the actual design. But there are what they've actually participated actually goes right in. Now, what I also want to mention, the last two projects specifically, and even more so the Cultural Trust project, the last one I showed in Pittsburgh, is that that project will not look anything like that rendering. Not because what the rendering does is, the rendering is a way for people to understand that we heard you and that there is a framework and there's something to help it move forward, and people to understand a vision and be able to understand it in a way that they can relate to. One thing I noticed all the time, biggest problem in urban design, is that too many people use plans and to just talk about their work way too often, and sometimes even elevations. You're not going to go anywhere, because even as architects, we think we understand plans, and we probably do more than at the everyday. But the experience of people that you work with in working on plans are, they've almost never looked at them. So, when you look at something three-dimensional, you're putting people into the place. But what it is it's a moment in time, and then, but like, for example, the culture trust, that's going to take 20 years to build out. Who can predict that? You know, and they're going to have four or five different architects working on the different parcels there. But if they, but what we're trying to get at is trying to help set a framework for the machine. You know, that what I started with is the idea of what is the overall goal. And you also remember that I mentioned is that, yes, it becomes an architectural problem. And then there are urban design characteristics that go within it in terms of programming, and you can make decisions and things like that. And hopefully that'll allow for it to grow and change and evolve. But the ground levels, for sure, are something. So oftentimes what we're helping do is helping development move forward and helping set a kind of course for things to happen, particularly in our urban design work. But there's oftentimes it's very much we take the temperature of the client, and they tell us a little bit about how much they want us to direct or to make the tools to the designers to move forward. So if it's all about the ground level, which is really the most active part of the city, we may just leave it at where that's located, and then they can go from there. So things can be very different and very much change over time. We love to see the flexibility, which you addressed in your comment, is how does things decay, and but at the, how are they also changed and used and things like that, and how do the patina start to get there that reflect the city? Wherever we go, they're oftentimes using local materials and local, local patterns and local styles and local craftsmen that are developing their own projects. So we're not bringing that there, but they're working locally in that way. So hope that opened. Do you have anything else, or is that if I answered your question?
We're gonna have dinner afterwards.
Sure, I can talk about it more. Sure.
You mentioned codes. I mean, I don't mm-hmm. really use the word codes, but. That's also obviously a critical issue, and I'm just wondering, in some ways the same theme, the idea of control mm-hmm. and how you provide enough variability within mm-hmm. covenants, or, and again, even landscape maintenance, landscape mm-hmm. covenants, you know, where
yeah.
everybody has to keep their grass to a certain height and use certain plants. Yep. You look at something like the Eastern Harbor District in Amsterdam, mm-hmm. and you look at that had a very innovative code that allowed enough variation that you mm-hmm. have this, I think, to me at least, an amazingly, mm-hmm. in many ways traditional, mm-hmm. but has some pretty provocative, mm-hmm. Shocking kind of moves at the large scale, mm-hmm. like slicing a diagonal through
yep.
to connect two buildings you yep. know, that are far apart. Things like that. Can you just talk about the idea of control?
The question is about the idea of control and codes and how much to put, you know, how much you turn the dials. So it's interesting because we're usually asked to do everything in between, from just give us the vision, which allows to kind of help people
find their agreements
and get entitlements and get things moving, to all the way to we really want something that's a very tight script. It really depends on kind of the client and the kind of, we let the people tell us what they want to see. Sometimes certainty is important, is sometimes as much for the adjacent property as know what's gonna go there than anything else. And sometimes it's through kind of a distrust at times of abuses that have happened in the past, when oftentimes design was not present. So it's a little bit of a challenge in that regard. But codes is a very, very big thing. And generally in cities, you have to have a good percentage. You have to have, I like to say 70% of, kind of just general fabric. You need to have, 28% of, or 27% of some really good architecture. You need to have 3% of like absurdity. And generally in cities, you have to have tension. Generally, like if you find any place that's perfect, or is generally you get bored of pretty quickly. I mean, I had a client of ours that said, I had this one car, and it was just perfect. Everything about that car, it drove perfectly, it turned perfectly, everything was perfect. But I never loved that car. I don't know if that's true for everybody, but generally, if everything's perfect, you generally don't have the same love for it that you do. I mean, I happen to love Pittsburgh, and it has so many flaws. I mean, I'll tell you, it's like, but I love it for what it is, and the cracked sidewalks and some of the things just kind of add to the charm, but there are a lot of great things to talk about Pittsburgh, but codes are an interesting problem, and I do work for, I am a board member at Riverlife, which is the organization that's working along the rivers. And what we're trying to do is we have noticed that right now the zoning was so light that we were oftentimes getting the poor, more often than not, we were getting the challenges that come with a bad code. So you're getting people putting parking garages up against the river and all these things. So oftentimes what we're doing is we're just trying to get the pieces to be set right to help things happen. I personally am not a big fan of kind of codes that go all the way extremely tight, but I'm also find that you can deal with, you really can have unintended consequences of having a place that's completely free of codes. There are certain cities where there are areas, and there's one in Pittsburgh which has almost everything goes. There's districts like that, and some of the results can be wonderful, and some of them can be quite frustrating. But so it's a larger discussion than we can have just for today. But I appreciate the question. Yes.
I think it is a follow-up question, and I'm going to start with a recent study that I think is analogous to the question to illustrate it. So there was a study, I think it was in 2012 or 2013, that looked at the complexity of chords in music since 1950, and noticed that the chord complexity, basically music was becoming more predictable, much simpler, mm-hmm. and much louder over that time, in terms of just kind of the transition between the chords becoming mm-hmm. much simpler, the number of chords, features mm-hmm. within music, et cetera. And so the researchers began to hypothesize why this would be.
Yeah.
And their attention immediately came to the DJ. And that the DJ, over the same time period, began to fade away in terms of their role of exposing the public to mm-hmm. new genres of music or different
yeah.
types of music that they, and in its place has mm-hmm. come recently things like Shazam, of course, mm-hmm. where we hear something in a bar and we immediately say, what's that? I want to hear more of that. Which then, of course, people can buy that data and provide music that very much is more like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's this kind of self-selection where everything does, of course, kind of congeal mm-hmm. around a few things that we like because we've heard it.
Yeah.
And the DJ then, of course, kind of fades to the back.
Mm-hmm.
And it's based on the comment you offered earlier, and as this is coming from someone that has mm-hmm. nothing but understanding in working with communities and collaborating with folks around what's happening in your neighborhood, what should happen in your neighborhood,
yes.
right? How do you, in that, in oftentimes, mm-hmm. when you get in those conversations, you'll find, no matter, and I've practiced in around the world, in Bolivia or wherever, and you'll see the answers are very much the same, even across nations,
yeah.
where this is how we'll answer. You brought up one of them, the cliche of retail, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, well, the retail will solve it,
yeah.
right? And even arts, one could argue now, is the same kind of cliche. We'll
yeah.
wave a magic art brush mm-hmm. downtown, and it's gonna fix it. And my question, and the reason I started with analogies, is where do you think our role as design professionals is as in that kind of DJ place where we aren't slavishly responding to the members of the community, which will lead us to a place of sameness as the members of the community play off of things that they've seen, whether they be seaside or whether they be the interesting piece of the city that mm-hmm. they like
yeah.
you know, in their backyard.
Mm-hmm.
And when do we need to more stop and listen? Like, how do you kind of create a balance between those conflicting demands? Like being responsive, but at the same time,
yeah.
you know, instigating at times.
Yeah, that's
and what do you use to instigate?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's just for the folks at home. I thought I loved your the way you started. It was great. The 2013, there was a study that said that music had gotten a little bit more and more similar in some areas, and that they found that it was more of the DJ that might have been the way that it happened. And kind of when you know we look into the world, you know, how do we, you know, where is our place in the world and in design and so forth. And you know, what are the tools that we use, and how do we listen, and when do we listen? You know, I think, you know, it's interesting you mentioned about music. I don't know a whole lot about music, but I do know that when you, and you mentioned a little bit today with iPods, you can be your own DJ, you can select your own things. One of the problems today is that people are listening out of headphone speakers, which generally don't have the same kind of richness of sound than, you know, a former record player. So you're probably finding that today we need to be the speaker. We need to find a way to change the speaker and change the discussion. More often than not, when we come into a place, you know, usually it's what's happening is it's completely locked up. Like no one can really find, we really are like third party arbiters. We're really problem solvers, actually. It's so funny because our projects, no one ever comes to us with anything easy. Like, we just, one of these days, we've got to think, can we please have just an easy project? It's always just, it's just so challenging. But what we oftentimes do is just get people to talk to each other and get people to work things out together. So I did show one project in Pittsburgh. It's the only, we have like one project every 2 or 3 years in Pittsburgh. That's it. Our projects are usually outside of Pittsburgh. And it's more often than not because we serve as kind of a third party arbitrator. And so oftentimes what happens is that, you know, one group doesn't trust the other group, doesn't trust the other group, but they all trust us. So we tend to be the ones that kind of shuttle between them. And we say, you're hearing this and we're hearing this, and we can try to find a way to pull things together. But in terms of how, going back to the speaker idea, is that we oftentimes will bring examples of places where things have worked and what we can do to help solve their problem and help them kind of navigate through it. So we have to be able to speak in the language that they speak, but help them understand the wider range of what can happen there. Just because something's been doing, you know, I mentioned about the richness of places and kind of what's inherently great about being in, you know, for example, in the South, you know, or another place, or the West, or whatever. It's not, you have to insist on a kind of broad inheritance of things that you can take advantage of today. Just because you've been doing it one way, there's so much to take advantage of. And what we have to do is we have to carefully select those pieces and bring that in to the discussion to help increase the speaker, I would say. So. Anything else? Yep.
Quick question. About 20 years ago, Max Bond, the African-American architect in New York, talked about what he said was he lamented what he called the lack of the middle ground in architecture. Essentially meaning you were sort of famous and celebrated and everyone knew what you did, and the sort of middle ground sort of was dissipating in the end of the lower end, of course, nobody cared. So my point is that as I look at the work of new urbanists and projects and firms like yours, my impression is while you're recognized in doing sort of master planning and urban design work, it doesn't seem like you're also making the same inroads in terms of architectural awards. So my question is, do you think that you represent that new middle ground, and do you think that the architecture profession will start moving you up in rank, so to speak, to the higher level design recognition?
So the question is that there's a lack of, perhaps there's a lack of middle ground, and that have been recognized for master planning, but not for architecture in the full range of the discussion. I'm not here to present this at kind of high level architecture and to be honest with you, I started at the level of design when I was working at an architecture office that was winning national awards. I worked for Rem Koolhaas, and you know, I mean, I worked for SOM. I understand that kind of level of detail, but what I'd rather have is more architects participating together. So am I interested in that scene? No. What I would much rather do is see, I'm much more enchanted by the idea of getting a lot of people together working, and particularly local architects working and helping that. So if that addresses that middle ground, I think that's your question, I think that's great. I think architects too often, and I think this challenge goes to you as a school, is that too often times we train architects for a sole purpose, and that there's so many different ways of which to use an architecture degree. And I think that as architects start to broaden their perspective and broaden the ability to work on different things, the better it's going to be for the architecture profession. I always, when I was president of AMI, local AIA chapter, I really asked ourselves, do we have the right awards? Are we awarding people in the right way? Which may go a little bit to your question, is we always add awards for the absolute best, you know, project. And I remember we had a discussion at one of our local AIA events, and somebody said, one of the people at the table said, you know what, I'll never give an award to to a project that has a steel panel door in it, never, because they didn't go the whole way. And to me, that raises the question of social equity, and it raises a question of, raises a social questions, is maybe we're doing something wrong. And I don't know what that answer is, but I think there are a lot of ways people can provide design and practice. And one thing I didn't show a little bit is that the scale of our work, we actually do get down to the kind of small grain. Oftentimes our clients will call us about something extremely small and that we won't share with everybody, but to a point where it's like just getting something working that's at a very kind of micro scale, which is something that's really important to us, is making sure these things are working. So we do work at times at that scale, and sometimes those small items can make a huge difference for a community. How you package that and contribute and help explain that to people can sometimes be extremely laborious to do, or you know. But I personally feel that it's great to see people, architects out there in the community and working. But really, that listening is one of the critical components to understanding those challenges that are out there and how you can help people in your community. Thanks. Anything else? Well, thank you very much for listening.